Hey guys, this is David Kwan. So, I've definitely moved backward. I started talking about Mass Effect 3 in one video, and the next video was Mass Effect 2, and now we're finally down to Mass Effect 1, the original game that came out on Xbox 360 and PC. I first played this game on my friend's Xbox 360 like years ago. Must have been like 7 years ago, 7 or 6 years ago when it like was first released. So way back when, and I haven't played it since. So my memory of that game is very fuzzy, but I can definitely pick out my favorite character from this game. I actually had to go check out the wiki page to remember the name of this character. That's how long it's been since I played this game. But for some reason, I was like thinking. Anyway, that's gonna spoil too much of who this character is before having you guys guess at it. But it's a male character. It's not a playable character. Mass Effect, compared to its sequels, has the least amount of characters, but it's a very tightly focused game. I think the pacing of Mass Effect 1 is the strongest compared to Mass Effect 2 and Mass Effect 3. When I first played Mass Effect 1, and then I beat it and I started talking about it with my friends started like, you know, it almost started like a flame war among us friends, because I was harsh on Mass Effect. I was really harsh. Like, I was just like, I don't like this about this game. This is a flaw right here. On one time, and this got my friends really upset, and N7 Normandy 1, if you're watching this, you'll probably be upset too. Because I was just like, Mass Effect 1, if I have to simplify it, this is what I said back then, and I still kind of agree, even though I haven't played it since then. Mass Effect 1, the 360 version, it's like a beta test for the PC version. That's what I said. And my friends were like, what the hell are you talking about? This is such an amazing game. Like, how dare you insult this game like that? Anyway, but that was my thoughts back then, just because the loading times, which happen so frequently, and it's like 5 second load or 3 second load every time you enter like new areas, the pop-ins are crazy, the long elevator. Okay, anyway. Games, the game issues aside, on none of these issues, and my friend had also had the PC version. I don't remember which friend, but I was just like, whoa, the PC version, none of these problems exist. Like, so that's why I said that Mass Effect 1 on the 360 is like a beta test for the PC version, which is pretty offensive thing to say to any Mass Effect fan. And I also think I made some of my friends mad because I read this review on one site. I think it was Thunderbolt. I think that's the name of the review site. Not too sure. But Thunderbolt gave Mass Effect a score of 6. And they had all these reasons. I was just like, the controls of the Mako vehicle are frustratingly terrible. The copy and paste level design when you go into side missions. And I was just like, I totally agree. Anyway, that aside, while I don't think Mass Effect 1 is a very strong game to play, has a lot of flaws, story-wise and its pacing-wise, I think Mass Effect 1 is the most cohesive compared to Mass Effect 2 and Mass Effect 3. It has a personal narrative because it's not about the threat of the entire universe being destroyed by Reapers. That's 3. And that kind of plot is kind of, it gets cliche and it ends up having an ending that is inevitable to be really controversial and quite honestly, crappily, really badly executed, which is the case for Mass Effect 3. Mass Effect 2 is mostly just character driven, and one of the main criticisms of Mass Effect 2 storytelling is that it none of it feels urgent. You kind of go in here, go in there, doing this, recruiting this character, doing this side mission. The urgency of what's at stake is hard to be felt when you're playing Mass Effect 2, which I guess is not a big problem because the game is really fun to play and because the characters are so awesome and I became really attached to the characters. But when you consider the overall picture, that lack of urgency, it can be a little bit detrimental because the whole game feels like a little distraction or just collection of side quests. Mass Effect 1 never feels that way, or rarely feels that way. It's a tightly structured story. It has moments of choices where it feels impactful and personal. It does that by having you attached to his characters. You'll notice that all these choice moments in Mass Effect 1 is about characters. In Mass Effect 2, that's not really the case. Mass Effect 3, the choice moments, or you know, the decision moments, are really large in scope. Like, do you decide, you know, whether the Krogans become sterile or not? You know, that's one of the choices in Mass Effect 3. Which civilization, the Geth or Koryans, do you choose to not become extinct? And then the final choice, of course, about the Reapers. These are large-scale decisions that are not about characters, but about civilizations, about universe in general. Mass Effect 1 doesn't have those choices. The decisions, well, maybe it kind of does, but the decisions are about a specific character. The spider. What was that race called? The Rachni. The Rachni Queen. What do you do with her? What do you do with that character? What do you do? Who do you save? Ashley or Kaiden? It's about the decision moments you have are about characters in Mass Effect 1. And I think that's really powerful. It makes you super emotionally invested into what you're doing. And so in that aspect, Mass Effect 1 story is super compelling. And that's why I played it 2 times. I beat it, and then I immediately went to my second playthrough, even though, honestly, I thought the game was very lacking in the gameplay front. I know I probably upset a lot of Mass Effect fans out there, but that's what I really love, like, the RPG aspect of it, which is sequels abandoned. Like, the customization of weapons, or not customization, but item management, squad management, leveling up of your character, you know, the progression of that. The sequels pretty much abandoned that altogether and just came up with their own things, making it more into a third-person shooter than a role-playing game. Mass Effect 1 was more of a true role-playing game than Mass Effect 2 or Mass Effect 3, which, honestly, to me, I love role-playing games, so that was a bit disappointing. But even though I love this RPG mechanics, I can't get over, you know, its glaring flaws in game designs, and especially the 360 game issues, glitches and loading times and pop-ins and graphical issues and whatnot. But this video is about characters, and I still haven't talked about my favorite character from the game. And this character is only in Mass Effect 1, is not in Mass Effect 2 or Mass Effect 3. Because he dies in Mass Effect 1, and that's Saren. Now, I said I forgot his name, but when I was thinking to do this video, what kept popping up in my mind was, like, Saren. And I was like, wait, no, that's a character from Lord of the Rings. Why am I thinking of Saren, or Sauron, sorry, pronunciation just butchering right there, sorry guys. But Saren, and I was like, why am I thinking of Saren from Lord of the Rings when I'm trying to think about Mass Effect 1? And then I look at Wikipedia and it's like, oh, because their names are so damn similar. That's why. But yeah, like it's pretty amazing. I think he's the best villain in the entire franchise. He's like the only villain that's like a real villain in the franchise. And when you actually come to find out his motives, that he already accepted that Reapers are going to come, and Reapers are going to pretty much win, so why fight a battle you can't win? Why not join the forces that are already going to pretty much control the universe? So his reasoning is, Saren's motive in turning over to the Reapers and becoming pretty much their puppet or their servant is a powerful thing. And then you come to learn of Saren's motive after meeting up with Sovereign, a representative of the Reaper race. And Sovereign's speech is one of those spine-chilling speeches, like, whoa, that was amazing, kind of thing. And then you kind of digest that, and then you come to face-to-face with Saren, who almost kills you, and then pretty much coming face-to-face with Saren makes you choose between two of your characters. It was an easy choice for me, because I don't like Ashley. never liked Ashley. But it's which is weird because me personally, I mean, if you watched all my videos, previous videos, and talk about characters, I really like strong female characters, and Ashley is a strong female character. But I find her, I just found her really annoying and just one-dimensional and flat. So I guess that's also a criteria for me. A character has to be deep and not just strong and not just female. Ashley definitely was not a deep character. She was just kind of there. At least Miranda is a little better than Ashley to me, but it's just... Those two characters are probably my least favorite, the whole franchise. But yeah, you have this emotional choice, and even though I didn't like Ashley, like, that's still a pretty powerful choice. And then it's an even more powerful moment when coming face to face with Sauron, depending on what you chose to do with, was it Rex? I think that's the Krogan's name. I don't know if I'm getting the character's name wrong, but... You decide the fate of the Krogan, if my memory serves me right. You have to choose what to do, the Renegade option or the Paragon option. I feel like the Renegade option doesn't really make sense because of the attachment Shepard as a character grew to have with the Krogan, but the choice is entirely up to the player, which is one of the strong features of Mass Effect. But I obviously chose the Paragon option. But yeah. After those choices, you finally come to learn of Sauron's motive, which to me was the wow moment, which is like, whoa. So that's why he's been doing all this thing all this time as a Spectre. And the entire plot of Mass Effect is, most of it, is chasing down this rogue Spectre. It's a personal journey, like, it's to track down this one guy, and it's not a journey to gather up different races or different civilization or to recruit different characters to save humanity from the destruction from Reapers. It's not a grandiose, large-scale plot. It's a personal plot. If it wasn't for Sauron, who's definitely the most important character in Mass Effect 1, without a doubt, if it wasn't for Sauron turning out to serve the Reapers, Shepard would never have even become a Spectre. He's the first human to become a Spectre, and he's given that status to track down Sauron. So this is the story of how Shepard came to be a renowned hero of the universe, of how he came to track down Sauron and pretty much introduce the world that Reapers might be out there and might be coming to destroy civilization once again, just as they have done 50,000 years ago. So this is the Mass Effect 1's purpose in the entire franchise, is to set up the premise that the Reapers are out there. And Reapers are never mentioned, like, you never face a Reaper in Mass Effect 1. In Mass Effect 2, you face one Reaper. But Mass Effect 1, you never face a Reaper. You only know the rumors of it. And that keeps the intrigue, the mystery of, like, this incoming threat that might or might not be real, and the moment you realize that it is, that's pretty much when the game ends. And I think that was a really good way to end it. Because it leaves you hanging to, like, want to know how it would continue. Because it was promised, after the game was released, the sequel would carry on with whatever choices you made in this game. It's going to carry over to the next game, and the story will continue with your own personalized version. One of the biggest selling points of Mass Effect 1, the way Mass Effect 2 did it, like, it left out a lot of details in that personalization, but it's still a cool concept that what you did in one game carries over to the next game. It's still a revolutionary concept. But anyway, that's why, to me, you know, Sauron's character had such a big impact on me, because it's just like, after all those moments, I finally come against this guy who is really idealistic, but at the same time, he has this weird, twisted motive and just makes you think. That was the most amazing thing to me about Mass Effect 1. And at this point, I haven't come to... When I'm just considering Mass Effect 1, I haven't grown attached to any of the characters in Mass Effect 1. Lyra is kind of barely, you know, she's interesting, but she hasn't really become fleshed out in Mass Effect 1. Ashley is annoying. Kaiden is kind of on the surface. Rex is an awesome character in Mass Effect 1, but he doesn't have much screen time in my memory. He might have, actually. I don't know. In my memory, he doesn't. And Saren definitely doesn't have much screen time, but he has a big impact. Sovereign, I don't know if you would consider him as a character. And Joker is kind of like the side character who's kind of the comic relief. Kind of there, but not that integral. I guess, aside from Saren, my second favorite character would be Garrus. Garrus is definitely, by that, even up to Mass Effect 1, he's a character I get. I understand him. I know where he's coming from. This is a character with a defined set of personality. The other characters are waiting for the sequels for their personalities to really develop and come to fruition, except for a few characters like Ashley, who doesn't ever develop that, in my opinion. But yeah, that's why Saren to me really stands out in the first Mass Effect game. So with that said, this has been quite a long series of video in talking about all three Mass Effect games. I guess in the next video, I want to talk about Lyra, actually, because I already spoiled it. You know, she's my favorite character from the entire Mass Effect franchise, and I think I need to talk about her more. So next video, I am going to talk about Lyra to Sony, and then I'll end it here. And you know, if you have a character, you know, from Mass Effect 1 who you consider as your favorite, you know, feel free to leave a comment. Let me know who you thought was your favorite. If you have a reason, go for it. If not, that's totally fine too. And tell me also if you didn't like Ashley as much as me. Am I the only person who just did not like Ashley as a character and found her to be completely boring? I don't know. All right.